whole scene disappeared, and Scrooge found himself once more alone back in his chair. Scrooge drifted off to sleep, only to be awakened again by the stroke of one. Looking about, he gradually noticed a great blaze of ruddy light. Something was in the room. Scrooge beheld his chamber, and it was transformed. The walls and ceiling were so hung with living green that it looked a perfect throne. Around the fire lay a feast of meats and fruits and seething bowls of punch. And there stood a jolly giant, glorious to see. She bore a glowing torch shaped like Plenty's horn and held it up, high up, to shed its light on Scrooge as he crawled, peeping from his chair.
Come, Ebenezer Scrooge, come. Come and know me better, man. I am the ghost of Christmas present. You have never seen the likes of me before.
Spirit, I went forth last night on compulsion and learned a lesson that's working now. If you have aught to teach me, let me profit by it.
Very well, touch my robe.
And instantly they were transported to the streets of London on a bright Christmas day. The shops were all bustling with jolly people completing their errands or returning from church. The grocers, the poultry and fruit shops, they were all so busy, and it was all such a delight. Presently, Scrooge and the spirit came to Camden Town, to a humble house on a humble street.
Spirit, this is the home of my clerk, Bob Cratchit, his wife, children. Why are we here?
Whatever has got your precious father, then? And your brother, Tiny Tim.
Oh, but here's Martha, Mother. Hurrah!
Sorry I'm late, Mother. But I had a deal of work to finish up last night and clear away this morning.
Never mind, my dear, so long as you are here. Sit ye by the fire and have it warm. Lord bless you.
No, Martha, hi! Father's coming! Father, Father!
Ah, Harriet! Belinda, Peter! Why, where's our Martha?
Not coming.
Not coming? Not coming upon Christmas Day?
Here I am, Father. Merry Christmas.
So, how did Tim behave in church today, Bob?
Good as gold, Mother, and better. Hey, Tim.
They sang ever so nice, Father. I hope the people saw me in the church. Because I'm a cripple, and it might be pleasant to them to remember on Christmas who made Laban walk in blind man's sight.
God bless you, my sons. See, Mother, his heart is strong, and he will get better. I know it.
Oh, please do.
Washington will live.
I see a vacant seat by the chimney and a crutch without an owner. If these shadows remain unaltered by the future, the child will die.
Oh, kind spirit, tell me he'll be spared.
But why? If he'd be like to die, he'd better go on and do it and decrease the surplus population.
Use my words against me.
Yes, and perhaps in the future you will learn to hold your tongue until you learn what the surplus population is and where it is. Perhaps in the sight of heaven you are more worthless and less fit to live than millions like this man's poor child.
Here's the punch. Steamy hot. Take your turn. There's enough for a toast. And one after that.
A toast to Christmas.
I would like to propose a toast to Mr. Scrooge, the founder of the feast. To Mr. Scrooge.
What?
No, Father.
Not him.
Of the feast, indeed. I wish I had Mr. Scrooge here to give him a piece of my mind to feast upon, and I'd hope he'd have a good appetite for it.
My dear, it is Christmas Day.
I'll drink to his health for your sake and the day's, not his. Long life to him, a Merry Christmas, and a Happy New Year. I'm sure he'll be very merry and very happy. I have no doubt.
Come, Ebenezer, to a gathering across town.
My nephew Fred, his wife Kate, and their many hungry friends.
And then he said Christmas was a humbug. And he believed it, too, as I live.
More shame for him, Fred.
Oh, he's a comical old fellow, and not so pleasant as he might be. However, his offenses carry their own punishments, and I have nothing to say against him.
I'm sure he's very rich. At least you always tell me so.
Oh, what of it, my dear wife? His wealth is of no use to him. He doesn't make himself comfortable with it.
Well, I have no patience with him.
Oh, well, I have. I couldn't be angry with him if I tried. Who suffers by his ill wits? Himself, always. I mean to give him the same chance every year, whether he likes it or not.
Wonder where Topper is. Oh, Topper!
Oh.
Stop playing blind man's buff!
Come now, Topper. Kate's sister knows that you cheat, I think.
Oh, our furnishings. Come, let's play at forfeits.
No!
The game of yes and no. Come, dear husband, think of something. And we have to find out what.
Okay. Ah, got it. Quick now, ask away.
Vegetable.
No.
Animal.
Yes.
A friendly animal.
No. Disagreeable.
Ah, yes.
Solid.
Yes.
Grunts, growls.
Yes to both, sometimes.
Lives in London, in a menagerie.
Yes and no.
Walks the street?
Yes.
A horse?
And no.
Then it's a bull?
No.
A tiger?
No.
A bear?
No.
mulled wine ready at our hands. A Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year to the old man, whatever he is. He wouldn't take it from me, but he may have it all the same. To Uncle Scrooge.
To Uncle Scrooge.
To the streets of London for the spirit's final lesson, but the spirit had aged.
My time upon this globe grows very brief. My time with you, Ebenezer, is almost done. Have you learned from what I have shown you about the good in most men's hearts?
Well, how can I know? How can I promise? I may be too old to change.
If it's too hard a lesson to learn, look here upon these.
Too miserable. Heinous, yellowing children there, yellow, meager, and scowling. Are they yours, sir?
They are man's children. This boy is ignorant, and this girl is want. Beware them both in all their degree. But most of all, beware this boy, for upon his brow I see that written which is doomed. Without the spirit of Christmas to comfort them, narrow puritanism and greed would release these wretched beings.
Have they no refuge? Have they no resource?
Are there no workhouses? Are there no prisons? Are there no workhouses? Are there no prisons?
And with that, the ghost of Christmas present dissolved into the mist, and Scrooge was left once again alone upon the street. As the last stroke of midnight rang, Scrooge remembered the prediction of old Jacob Marley, and lifting his eyes, he beheld the third spirit, a solemn phantom shrouded in black, draped and hooded, coming like a mist along the ground towards him.
I'm the presence of the ghost of Christmas yet to come. Will show me shadows of things that have not happened, but will happen. Spirit, will you not speak to me? Ghost of the future, I fear you more than any specter I have seen, but as I know it is your will to do me